You know, all the gunfire and watching that, you didn't even flinch, Nic Robertson. I mean, hearing all of that, being surrounded by it, what's happening in the skies. I mean, just a really honest question is, are you ever frightened?
When you see the guns and you hear the gunfire, you know there's gunfire. It's when you don't see the guns and you hear gunfire, then you start to worry. Then you flinch. And I find you come out of that environment and then you hear the gunfire, like watching that right now. And I was like, oh.
You flinch now.
Yeah.
After the fact. I want to get to some more of your report, and we've pulled some more video. This is the moment when a woman, then unknown, she's approaching here. She's approaching a group of journalists to say that she had been raped by forces loyal to Muammar Gaddafi. We're going to let you pick it up here. Let's listen to that moment. So that is the story of Iman al-Obeidi, and I know we have told her story, and so if I may, I want to pick up with the other part of the story, I know you saw a lot of, which is the government minders, these officials who turn up, I'm guessing out of nowhere. Are they following your every move when you're there in Tripoli, and if they are, did that hamper at all any of your reporting?
You know, they're all over the hotel, these government officials, and you know that they're there because they're the same guys that are going to be going out with you on the sort of government sponsored trips, but you don't realize that they're going to actually physically pull a gun on you in the hotel, as happened to our cameraman Halil Abdullah. Mm-hmm. You don't realize that they're going to take your camera away from you and smash it on the floor of the hotel. So,
which they did to you all.
Which they did. So, I mean, it comes as a shock. You know these guys are there, but you don't know they're going to react in this way and respond in this way.
And you and I were talking earlier today, just across the street, literally across the street to go grab a drink. They finally stop tailing you.
Sometimes.
I
mean, Halil and Tommy Evans, my producer, went out to buy drinks at the store. I tried to go out 2 minutes after them to join them, and I got stopped to the gates by the police as well. The police and then government minders. And when I said, try to say, look, I'm with those guys, they started physically holding me back. And
wow.
The control, but this was a progression. When we first went there, the government there didn't have any idea of what it meant to let in 130 journalists. They didn't realize that we were just going to go everywhere and do what we wanted to do. And they realized, and then they started putting in more security people, less intellectuals around us, and more thugs to kind of control us. And that's what they did.
And I know you have a lot of contacts. You have sources within the Libyan government. So we have some more video. You've met several of Gaddafi's sons. You have met with his son Saadi. You've also met with his son Saif. And in speaking with them, did you learn anything with regard to their father? How do they feel about their father? Would they at all be willing to have him step down, to leave the country?
Leave the country, that's different. Step down, yes.
Leave the country, no.
They say he would be afraid of being caught up and taken to the Hague International Criminal Tribunal. He does for war crimes. They don't want that to happen. The father wants some kind of sort of recognition for his hero status in the country, which he had several decades ago amongst some Libyans.
And amongst some tribes still today.
So they would like to see him, and they do expect to see him step down and step aside, but not, as they say, at the point of a gun, and not as an initial starting position on negotiations.
What about the mood among the Libyans? I know for the most part, perhaps all of the time, you've been in the capital city of Tripoli, which is far from the major, major fighting. And so you haven't had the bombs. How does that affect? Do people within Tripoli, I don't know, psychologically, are they aware there's this war raging on?
When they see the heavy anti-aircraft gunfire in the evening, and then they hear some of the bombs dropping and they hear the planes fly over, they register it, but then 3 or 4 hours later, the sun's out, the stores have got food in, they might be lining up for gas because there isn't so much gas, but it's sort of almost life as normal. It's not. But this is a psychology under war, that when it seems normal, when there's nothing dropping in front of you, nobody dropping dead in front of you, no bombs dropping at that minute, then you just get on with your life. People at night, I mean, I talk to people in that city, people who with the opposition that we can't put on camera and talk about while we're there. And they tell me, you know, my children are afraid. They tell me they can't sleep at night. They wake me up and say, Daddy, what's going on? So you hear some heart-wrenching stories from people who want Gaddafi gone. But they can't come out on the streets and say it, and they can't say it on camera. But they're all, at the same time, they're worried themselves about the bombing. Their kids are frightened.
You mentioned you're a father, you have children. Are they fully aware of what you do and the dangers involved in your job each and every day?
A long time ago, my daughter said to me, Daddy, you can't fool me. And she was right. And I can't fool her mom either.